The information in this lecture is provided for informational purposes only and is not intended to substitute for the advice provided by your doctor or other healthcare professionals. You should not rely upon or follow the program or techniques or use any of the products and services made available by or through the lecture without obtaining the advice of a physician or other healthcare professional. The nutritional and other information in this lecture are not intended to be and do not constitute healthcare or medical advice.
I want to just get a basic understanding of what the methylation cycle is. You can learn about like what it means when someone says MTHFR. And then what you really actually, the most important thing is this last thing, and that's like what should you do about it if you suspect you have a methylation problem. So the good thing about that last part is you guys just being here and being part of this organization is it's about as good as you can do on your own as far as things that you want to do to support methylation. Like Weston A. Price principles are right in line with what you would do for a poor methylation issue. So we'll talk about that in more detail. So methylation, it's a complicated topic, but in the end, it's actually really simple. All it means is I'm taking this carbon group, this carbon with three hydrogens, and I'm attaching it to something. But what that means is like this is how you go from making from the starting point of tryptophan, which is a lot of times people think of that as like a sleep inducer. So tryptophan, we use tryptophan to make serotonin. And if you can follow this pathway, we'll kind of show you where the methylation comes into play. So, and then ultimately, you actually make melatonin from serotonin. So if you look at this tryptophan, this is like your starting material. And then what happens is we take oxygen and we do this hydroxyl reaction. We put this little oxygen, we stick it over here, okay? This little process here is actually dependent on methylfolate, actually, so going from here to here, but that's not that important. All right, and then we're gonna do one other thing. We're gonna add this, we're gonna take away this CO2 group from over here, we're gonna take away this carbon dioxide to get to serotonin. So how many people have heard of like 5-hydroxy or 5-HTP, have you guys heard of that? Mm-hmm. So it's like a common supplement that people give for like depression and stuff. And it's mainly because it's like the direct precursor to serotonin. Okay, once we have serotonin here, you can see how we have this OH here. And now what we want to do is we want to add this methyl group. We want to add this CH3 on there. And by doing that, now we've made melatonin. So all methylation is just taking these CH3 groups and moving them around. But the reason why it's so important is it happens like a billion times a second in your body. So it's happening all the time. Okay? And not only is it happening all the time, but it's involved with like so many different processes. So some of the biggest places where methylation occurs is it like protects your DNA. So you'll hear the term like DNA methylation. So like making DNA and making RNA and making all these things that are encoded in our genetics, a lot of that is methylation dependent. All right, so a lot of people when they hear folic acid, the first thing they think about is like, oh, I take that when I'm pregnant. And the reason why they started doing that was they saw that prevented these neural tube defects, so like the cleft palates and things like that. And we're gonna get into talking about like methylfolate and not folic acid, but even from just having the general population eat more or consume more folic acid, they definitely had a decrease in neural tube defects. That's definitely occurred. Big things where methylation is important too is like anytime there's like cell turnover, so you can think of like your gut actually turns over, I think like every 2 weeks your gut turns over. So a lot of times people with like chronic gut issues, they might have a folic acid or a methylation issue. A big place where I see it when I'm treating patients is with immune function. You could have an anemia that's due to a methylation problem. Neurotransmitter production, so like making that serotonin, the first spot from going from tryptophan to that 5-HTP, that's actually kind of, it's not totally methylation, but it's involved in that process. And then a big thing where I see it when I'm treating patients is on the detox side. So like people that have a lot of allergies, a lot of like I don't know if you, another term that's kind of getting thrown a lot out there now is this mast cell activation syndrome, which is basically means like you're kind of allergic to the world. But essentially, your body's making a lot of histamine, and when you have a lot of histamine in your body, there's two strategies for it. One is you got to decrease the production of it, and the other part of it is you need to detox that out of your system. And one of the main detox pathways for histamine is methylation. A lot of females have issues with estrogen detox, and estrogen detox, it's dependent on other pathways, but methylation is a key one for that too. And just any chemical that your body has, so like detoxing MSG, that's really dependent on methylation, that's a big one. It's key for energy production. Now everyone complains of fatigue. I shouldn't say everyone, it's the most common complaint among patients across the board. So like, it might not be the reason you went to the doctor, but it's the most common complaint that you would find on like a symptom survey among any patient. So, I mean, obviously this list is pretty all encompassing as far as like diseases that could be affected by methylation. The bottom line, it's almost easier to say what methylation doesn't do than what it does do. Like, so essentially it's involved with everything. So if you have a methylation issue, it could literally affect anything in your body. Like any symptom could be driven from this issue with methylation. All right, so that CH3 group, that's the methyl group. So we need to have a place where we get these methyl groups in our body. So in order to take that serotonin and turn it into melatonin, we need to get that CH3 group from somewhere. So ultimately we need these methyl donors or these methyl sources. And there's three main methyl like sources in your body. One is methionine, which I don't know if you guys have heard of that, but that's an amino acid. So you have to get that from protein. And methionine is going to be like eggs are a good source of methionine. So like salt, like smelly proteins, so like sulfury type proteins are going to be higher in methionine. And it also turns out that choline, which is another source of these methyl groups, one of the best sources of choline is the yolk and eggs. So hopefully we don't have any vegans here, but you shouldn't be a vegan after this talk. But if you are a vegan, it's okay, but hopefully not by that. All right, and then the last two are is folic acid and B12. That can be a source of these methyl groups for us. So ultimately, has anyone heard of SAMe? Mm-hmm. Sometimes people take that as a supplement. SAMe is like the methyl driver, like the methyl bus driver, essentially. So in order to give that SAMe, or in order to give that methyl group to serotonin there to make melatonin, to get the methyl group there, it had to go on like the SAMe bus, basically. So like SAMe is like kind of like the transporter for it. All right. Okay. So this is probably really hard to see and a really complicated slide. I'm gonna try to make it as simple as possible. Okay. This is methionine. We talked about that a second ago. This is SAMe. So ultimately, if you're looking at this picture, we want to figure out how we can make this. Because if we can make this, that means we have enough methylation to go around, okay? So one way we get there is just straight from methionine. So if we eat protein comes down, our body breaks it down. One of the things we get out of that is methionine. And then there's a step here, but basically with magnesium, we can go from here to here. Okay, so that's one way. All right, so now say we got this SAMe and we come around and now we're gonna use it for something. Maybe we're gonna make melatonin. All right, so now we got rid of this methyl group, but now we don't have SAMe anymore. Now we've got this, which is called S-adenosyl homocysteine, which don't worry about the names, it doesn't matter. So this is SAH, okay? So this means we got rid of the methyl group, it's gone. all right? We need to get them again because this methylation is happening all the time. So now what happens is this comes down and turns into homocysteine. Who's heard of homocysteine? Because this is actually a pretty well-known chemical. It's necessary for our bodies, but it's also super toxic. So like homocysteine is not a good thing. We do not want this to accumulate. All right, that's a problem. All right, so now we're here, but we still need to make more of that. So there's two ways to get there. One, we can use betaine, which we get from choline. So choline turns into betaine. You can get betaine on your own from beets. Okay, so like eating beets is actually a good source of this. Like Standard Process has a supplement called Beta Food. I don't know if anyone's ever taken that. It's basically beets, and it's basically a betaine supplement is what it is. Or the other way to get back to here from here is we use methylfolate, okay? So say this is folic acid that we got from either our diet or a supplement. That's gonna come in and it's gonna turn into this methylene tetrahydrofolate. And to get from here to here, which is methyl tetrahydrofolate, this is where we get into this MTHFR thing. And we'll talk about that in more detail. But that's the thing that a lot of people like to call the mother effer gene because a lot of people have issues with it. All right, so once we have this, we give this methyl group to B12, and then B12 gives the methyl group back to homocysteine, and now we're back to here. And now the cycle keeps going, okay? There's another way, it won't give us more SAMe, but we don't want this to build up, this homocysteine here. So another thing that happens is from homocysteine, it will get diverted using B6 and magnesium into cystathione, which eventually becomes cysteine, and glutathione, and it also becomes like sulfur, which you need for like your joints and stuff, and taurine. But have you guys heard of glutathione? Mm-hmm. All right, so glutathione is like super important. It's like the magic bulletproof vest of your body, okay? So we're always in this state of kind of controlling these chemical bullets in our body, which are like free radicals. And you can almost think of as you age, a lot of that is like your body's like oxidizing, kind of like your body's rusting. Think of it that way, okay? So like if you leave something outside too long, it starts to rust. That's kind of like what's happening to us. So if we have enough glutathione around, that will protect us from that rusting, all right? So the one thing that happens is if you have too much oxidative stress in your body, meaning like you got too many of these chemical bullets flying around, your body's gonna divert this down in order so that you start making more glutathione. As a result, you won't make as much SAMe. So that might affect your methylation status. Is this making sense? And if you guys got questions, you can stop me because I know this isn't, we're not biochemists here. So you guys are good? All right. And if you want me to come back to this one, let me know, because it might make more sense as we're going along. So, all right. So why would someone be a poor methylator? And again, the reason why we care about being a poor methylator is because if you're a poor methylator, it could affect any of those other like disease processes that were going on, right? Like, you might not be able to make enough white blood cells, or maybe your gut doesn't turn over as well as it should. This is important, right? So, well, one, it could just be your diet is not good, right? Like if you aren't getting enough protein sources in your diet, you won't have enough starting material to begin with. Or maybe you aren't getting enough folate in your diet. And we'll talk about like the good sources of that. But I mean, this was enough of a problem that they decided like, hey, we better start putting folic acid in these foods that people are eating. That's why, right?
No the distinction of between folic acid and folate. I know Ben Lynch.
Yeah.
He really advises against folic acid, and you know, to make sure you get folate instead of folic acid.
Yeah, and I wouldn't disagree with that at all. Like folate, you're gonna get folate from your food, and there's really not much of a reason. There's really no reason to ever supplement with folic acid. Like you really shouldn't take like a folic acid supplement. There's better sources for that, but yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Except if you're over methylating.
Yeah, sort of. But I still wouldn't take folic acid, I think.
Yeah.
In that case, I would take like folinic.
Okay.
I wouldn't take like straight up. But even then, I probably wouldn't still take folic. I wouldn't take folate if I'm over methylating necessarily. I probably would like try to decrease the methyl donors or something, you know?
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that it's another big thing with this is it's all about balance. Like, you can be over methylated and under methylated. Like, that's an issue too, right?
Okay.
All right, so another reason why you might be a poor methylator is, well, maybe you just can't meet your methylation demands. Maybe you can't meet your methylation demands because you have a toxic, you're just super toxic, which we all live in like a toxic environment. It's just the way it is. But maybe yours is like, maybe you're like a drywaller or something and you're breathing in crap all the time. But the big one that we want to talk about here is this MTHFR. All right, so a lot of people have heard of this, and we're going to talk about that in more detail. As a side, folic acid and B12 go together, and a lot of people have B12 absorption issues because a lot of people have gut issues. It's super common. And another big reason why people might have methylation issues is due to like chronic infections, particularly viral infections. And we'll talk about that a little bit too. So what is MTHFR? All right, so MTHFR, when people say you have an MTHFR defect, it's basically what that means is that enzyme, there's an enzyme that helps your body get from here to here. And if you have that defect, that enzyme basically doesn't work as well as it should. And a lot of people have heard of these C677T or A1298C. These are basically the genetic tests that will tell you whether or not you have this genetic, I don't necessarily want to say defect, but just say, we'll say like genetic insufficiency. All right. So there's a lot of people that have these. It's super common. The results in this little chart here are from like a Dutch study. And this was based off of, I don't know how big the population was that they used, but of everyone that they tested, only 15% didn't have one of these gene defects, okay? If you have this one, that one's not so bad. So if you're gonna have one or the other, you'd rather have the A1298C, basically. So, oh, the other thing too is I should say that there's a heterozygous and a homozygous version of this defect, meaning like, you get one copy of your genes from your mom and you get one copy of your genes from your dad. So, say you have a double copy of this defect from both your parents, that means you're homozygous in A1298C, okay? So say you're doing pretty good, you only got one copy of this one, you're actually not doing so bad. It says that you're, based off of this study, that your MTHFR is at only 17% impaired, so it's still working pretty well, okay? The bad one is if you have the C677T and you have both copies of it. So both your parents decided to screw you and gave you that one, all right? Now based off of this, it says that your MTHFR activity is gonna be decreased by, could be as much as 75%, which is pretty significant, okay? All right, so how do you know if you have one of those genetic SNPs? So this is where like 23andMe and a lot of these like genetic tests that are available now can come into play. Some of your medical providers will actually, they can order these tests through Quest. Sometimes it's better to not go that route. But you can basically
get results from 23andMe, you give them a salivary sample. Based off the results you get from 23andMe, you don't actually have like the information to tell you whether or not you have these issues. You have to take this data and then submit it to either like to these other companies called, one is called Stratagene, which is that's one like Chris Mastrodon recommends, or like Genetic Genie. The total cost for these could be as much as $250. You might be able to get it done for about $100. So if having this testing is important to you, it's not crazy expensive to have it done, but it would be done.
Sure, it's paid for.
Yeah, I mean, some people's will, like some won't, you know. It just depends. Like, it's worth talking to your GP about it and see if they'll be willing to order the test and if your insurance will cover it. It's not always the case, but it's a good thing to know. Like, I mean, part of the other point of this talk is like, having this defect is not the end of the world either. Like, there's ways around it, okay? So another important thing though is like, all right, you might have one of these genetic defects, but you wanna know if you're a poor methylator or not, because that's actually what's important. Like, you don't necessarily wanna, it doesn't really matter if your body can meet the methylation demand, it doesn't really matter if you have the genetic defect or not. So like, these are ways you might be able to tell if you're a poor methylator. If you have a high homocysteine level, and homocysteine is a test, you should be able to get that from general practitioner. It depends on who you talk to. From a functional medicine perspective, I would say anything greater than 9 or 10 is going to be, it's higher than what you would want. It's not necessarily like super bad, but it'd be something to work on to bring that level down. Traditionally, this is kind of how I always looked at it, like from the people that taught me about this topic originally, like what they used was they would look at someone's CBC, and if the MCV number was greater than 91, that was an indicator that they might have a methylation or a folic acid B12 issue. If your white blood cell count is low, like sometimes you look at people's blood work and like they just can't get that white blood cell number up, like it should be over 5,000. And a lot of times that's a good indicator of poor methylation status. And if you look at your neutrophil percentages, so like people probably don't ever look at this stuff, but if you look at your blood work, they take your white blood cells and then they break them down into like the neutrophils and lymphocytes and eosinophils. And what you want to do is look at the percentage. And if the percentage of neutrophils is less than 55% of your total white blood count, that could be an indicator you have methylation issues. There's also some tests you can do to look at like your blood levels of methionine and glycine. I've never actually seen those, but they're just things that I've heard of that will relate to methylation status. And then there's other companies like Genova Diagnostics, they have other ways, like more advanced ways of kind of looking at people's methylation status. They'll look at specific methylation enzymes that might relate to like estrogen detox issues and things like that. But these tests are at least not a bad place to start, and your insurance should cover it, and it shouldn't be hard to order, truthfully. So, all right, you suspect you have a methylation issue. Whether you care if you have the defect or not, you look at those tests and you're like, all right, I know my methylation is poor, my homocysteine levels are kind of high. What should I do about it? And a lot of times we jump at like, all right, I'm just gonna start taking a ton of methylation supplements. Meaning like, these would be anything from 5-MTHF or methyl tetrahydrofolate is what it really is. Or you might, and some of the supplements that are out there are like really high doses. And they actually make a prescription version of 5-MTHF, which is, it's called Deplin. And that's like 15 milligrams, which is like really high to me. Like I really try to keep that, like, if I give like a 5-MTHF dose, it's like 1 to 2 milligrams is kind of like where I am. 15 milligrams just seems crazy, I mean. you might take methyl B12, or you might take supplemental choline, or you might take supplemental betaine. These are all things that are kind of part of this process. But the big thing too, and like part of the reason why you guys are here, is like you understand how everything needs a holistic approach. You can't just fix this stuff with a pill. Like the best way is really encompassing like a all natural diet. And the principles of Weston A. Price are really good. Like it really can be applied to any scenario. Like as far as any health issue, if you started with what they tell you here, you're gonna be better off. All right. So the first strategy would be to just increase your dietary folate. Now people can get into issues by taking too much folic acid supplements, but they really haven't found people that have issues by eating too much folate in the form of green leafy vegetables. And the three big ones are leafy greens, legumes, and liver. I know like Weston A. Price likes to have people eat organ meats. I just haven't, myself personally, I don't eat them. I'm not against them, but I've never really learned how to make them. And if someone wants to come to my house and cook them for me, I'll eat it. Yeah. Legumes, I'm a little hesitant putting legumes up there just because a lot of people have issues with digesting legumes, and if you aren't preparing them right, you might get into trouble. But if you're using like really like traditional methods, like really soaking legumes, then they can be pretty nutritious. It's just with so many people that I see have gut issues, legumes can be an issue. But if you have other issues with like meat and stuff and you're using legumes as like your protein sources, like just make sure you kind of, like Carol, like I'm not a cook. Like you guys probably have better knowledge on how you're actually supposed to prepare those things. So talk to them about like ways to soak your legumes and things like that. All right, the next thing, make sure you got enough protein in your diet. So methionine intake is important. So the minimum protein intake for 140 pound female is like 0.4 grams per pound of body weight. So that means if you're 140 pound female, you should at the very minimum should be having like 56 grams of protein. And one thing is like a lot of times people talk about like, I get protein from my peanut butter. It's like if you say you took like peanut butter and you slapped it on bacon or something, and you ate that, the only protein you're really getting is from that bacon. Because your body doesn't absorb the protein in that peanut butter that well. This is where like I kind of have like a bias towards a lot of like vegetarian type principles. This is because the bioavailability in animal protein is much better than what it is in vegetables or some of these other like methods that people use for getting their protein levels up. And the good thing about you guys being here is you're at least aware that where my animal protein comes from matters. So like getting the stuff from here is a big deal. You'll hear people talk about that documentary, like what the hell? You guys heard of that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So they bring up some good points, but like by you guys getting your stuff here, that makes a big difference. It kind of like discounts what that documentary was all about, you know? But on the flip side, or on the other end of the protein intake side, I actually think people need more than that 56 grams. Like, I would say, especially if you're fairly active and you're exercising, you probably need closer to like 0.68 grams, and it could even be maybe a little bit higher than that. So that means like 170 pound male, you might need 115 grams of protein, which is, you have to put some effort in to get that sometimes, you know? All right, so the next thing is, you remember back when we were looking at, we had homocysteine at the bottom and we were trying to get back up to that SAMe? Well, there's two ways to get there. One is by using methylfolate and B12. The other way to get there is by using betaine, which we got from choline, okay? So if we eat more choline, that will help spare our methylfolate. So if we're not good at making methylfolate, we want to make sure we eat a lot of something else that will kind of save it, okay? So that's where like choline can be super beneficial in this scenario. And best source choline, well, the best source is probably liver, but the best source that you're going to eat regularly is going to be like egg yolks. And raw dairy actually isn't a bad source of that either. So when we're talking about methylation, there's one process that uses up almost half your methylation capacity in your body, and that is the production of creatine. So who's here heard of creatine? Like for exercising, a lot of like bodybuilders you'd think use it. So creatine is part of our energy production. We have like three main energy production pathways in our body, and creatine is one of them. And the process of making creatine is the last step requires one of those CH3 groups, and that's where the majority of your methylation demand goes, is making this. So the same concept kind of applies here. If we're not good at making methylfolate, we should probably eat some choline. And if we're not good at methylating, then maybe we should lower that methylation demand by making sure we get some creatine in our diet and possibly supplement with that. And there can be issues with supplementing it, but in general, like, this is the kind of the thought process around it, okay? Another thing that happens when you have a methylfolate issue is your body has a tendency to spill out glycine. And glycine is actually a super important nutrient. For one, like when I'm treating a patient, where glycine will often show up is in the detoxification of someone's immune system. So you get a cold and your body produces all these like immune chemicals, and now you need to clear these chemicals out of your body. And typically, in order to get those out of your body, it's a glycination pathway in order to get that stuff out. So glycine is really good at like calming the immune system down. And truthfully, I would say, it's probably like 95% of my patients have some immune problem going on. So getting that immune system under control and like calming it down is like a big deal. And glycine can be really helpful for that. The best place to get glycine is from like the skin of the animal or like bone broth, that type of stuff. Collagen sources, essentially. So glycine is that'd probably be, there's a lot of other reasons to use bone broth. Glycine consumption is probably, to me, like the biggest reason why you'd want to do that. All right. And then after that, then you start looking at the supplementation. Unfortunately, like when I'm in practice, I probably go to the supplementation too quickly just because I'm impatient, like as much as the patient is, right? Like, in the ideal world, like, all right, I'd be like, all right, eat all these foods, but it just doesn't really like happen that way. So the nice thing is we have these supplements available, so we can supplement with methylfolate, we can supplement with methyl B12, we can supplement with glycine. The one that Chris Masterjohn, he likes to use for his glycine is this. Marine lipid, vital proteins, marine lipids, collagen or something. If you ever hear him talk, now Chris Masterjohn, like, that is one smart dude. Like, he definitely knows his biochem way better than I do. At the same time, he's not a clinician, so he probably wouldn't use methylfolate with somebody as frequently as I would. But part of that is just from what I see when I'm treating patients. Like just to give you a brief background on my use with methylfolate in practice, like when I first heard about it, I started using it all the time. And people would show a need for it all the time. I'm like, oh, this is awesome. But then you start to like have these patients that have these negative reactions to it, and that makes you a little gun shy using it. Then I would say, probably for a little while, I was like going out of my way to avoid giving it. And I'd be like, all right, well, if I can fix this person's gut issue, and if I can give them probiotics, which might help them improve their body's own production of folate, then they might not need it. And where I kind of am at now is, it's basically a combination. I definitely need to use it. It's like a, it's definitely a very important supplement that I carry. And it's definitely turned around patients that I was struggling with. But it's kind of good to keep it in mind that you don't want to be like just constantly loading people up with methylfolate. You want to look at these other causes of why they need so much of it. And if you can kind of address everything, then a lot of stuff can get better. Other things that are important for not necessarily methylation as much as not building up homocysteine, and that's where like B6 is really important. Other B vitamins are still involved with that whole pathway, like B1, B2, B3, everything kind of gets involved in there, so there are other things that can affect methylation. These are kind of the main ones: folic acid, B12, magnesium, and betaine. So glycine, we already talked about that. I'm always pushing healthy fats with patients. That's another good thing about Weston A. Price. That's like one of their founding principles, I would say. In general, for most people, their healthy fat consumption is not what it needs to be. And I'm always trying to promote grass-fed butter. That's one of the most common things I'm trying to push on patients. But omega-3s can be definitely beneficial. Coconut oil, things like that. And then antioxidants are really key for lowering that methylation lowering the diversion of homocysteine into glutathione. If you have a better antioxidant status in your body, then that homocysteine is more likely going to get converted back into that SAMe. And you're not going to, so if you have good antioxidant status in your body, it will improve your overall methylation status. And then the last thing is, go ahead.
Is Great Lakes gelatin a good source for glycine?
I'm not sure. I mean, gelatin probably would be. The one thing you have to worry about with some of the collagen sources is you might get a lot of MSG in them.
I thought Great Lakes was organic, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean,
it's grass fed.
It's organic, but it's one that Weston Price has at conferences or had at conferences.
Yeah.
It's probably okay. I'm just in general, like say you get actually just recently I was working with someone and they've been taking this like beef protein supplement. Actually that's becoming like a big thing, is like beef protein. And a lot of that's gonna have MSG in it. And it's part of it is just kind of the way it's processed, and even if it's like a clean company and stuff, it's just the way that it's made has a tendency to make MSG.
But yeah, it's not being added. It's just
naturally occurring.
You could take a protein supplement, and if you like spin it too hard or like were too violent with it, you're gonna make some MSG sometimes.
Even just cooking,
will
cause, you know, it's, you know, free glutamic acid, and some people who are hypersensitive will be sensitive.
Yeah, and glutamate's actually like a necessary nutrient. Like it's part of making glutathione. It's just a lot of people can be sensitive to it. So from my perspective, like the way I treat patients is I use muscle testing. That's like my big way of trying to figure out how someone is tolerating methylation supplements and if they need more methylation supplements. I did a demo last time I was here. We could do another one if someone wants to see that. But muscle testing can be a really cool tool because dosing out methylation nutrients can be a little bit difficult. And it can just give you a good idea on how the body is responding to that methylation supplement at any point in time. Like, that's the coolest thing about muscle testing, is it gives you the look at the nervous system in that instant. Whereas like when you do blood tests, you're getting like the sample of blood at that point in time, but things change, especially like immune stuff changes by the week and definitely changes like by the month. So that's where like muscle testing giving you this real-time look at what's going on with the person is a cool tool to use, but it's good to be aware of all that other stuff too. You know, it's nice like you have that, if you have those tests, like you know you have an MTHFR issue, it's good to know that, ideally you almost want to try to get it so where your body didn't show the need for methylfolate, that would be awesome. But it's nice knowing that stuff as a clinician, just the more information you have, the better. But that's about it, actually. So, how'd it go?
Excellent.
I am on a group for kids, and they said like stork bites, midline defects,
yeah, definitely sacral midline
dimples,
stuff.
Things
okay.
like that.
Oh, very
like,
interesting.
Like the back of the neck, the
yeah,
eye
yeah,
stork
yeah,
bites
yeah,
and
yeah,
stuff
yeah.
like that. And
yeah, like spina bifida. I mean, that would be
okay.
Like yeah, I mean, a lot of those things you would kind of throw with like the neural tube
sure.
issues would definitely classify. Mm-hmm. The one thing that's tough is it could literally be any symptom.
Okay.
Like that list of diseases that it's implicated in is like so extensive. Like, well, it might be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's hard to say that's definitely what's doing it. You know. And then I just feel like when I first learned about it, they were like, oh, it's like 15% of the population has this issue. And then the more and more you keep hearing about it, it's like the percentage keep going up. And the one thing I never really have gotten a good answer for is like, well, is there a genetic reason why you would want that defect? Is
right.
there some evolutionary advantage to that? And I don't know. Other than I just don't know. I haven't really found a good answer. Like a lot of that stuff, like Chris Mastodon's really good at that, like coming
right.
up with like the reason why, like someone that has high cholesterol, they might be more at risk for heart disease, even though that's like a kind of whole other conversation. But they're probably at less risk for developing Alzheimer's, honestly, because that cholesterol is actually really protective to their brain.
Mm-hmm.
And I know, like talking to you guys, cholesterol is not necessarily the end all be all with heart disease, but it's basically it's when your cholesterol oxidizes, when that LDL oxidizes, that's when it becomes a problem. So if the more cholesterol you have around, the more you're kind of more at risk for that oxidation, but whatever, that's a whole other freaking
yeah.
presentation. But I never really got a good explanation as to why that even exists, why the MTHFR is even a thing. But I don't know, if someone has one, be willing to listen.
Another question.
Yeah.
I've read Sally Pakalock's book about B12 and all
yeah.
that. Do you think it's safe to supplement with B12 for most people on a daily basis, or maybe not?
I give it frequently. I guess I haven't really heard contraindications to it.
Some, I just, you know, I always thought it was harmless to
yeah.
supplement. I, you know, with sublingual B12, methyl,
yeah.
you know, cobalamin. And then somebody recently said to me, oh, you shouldn't do that. And that's the first time I've heard that.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I know I use it all the time.
Yeah.
I mean, it shows up a lot. Like, people should test for it pretty frequently.
Right. Even if you're a methylator, it's just because of the poor absorption
yeah.
issue.
There's a lot that takes place for B12 absorption.
Right. It's like a 12-step process.
Yeah, like if you look at the back of the bottle of B12, it'll say, like, say it's like a 1 milligram B12. It's like 16,000% of what the RDA is.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially, what they're doing is you're just flooding the system and hoping enough gets through. You actually don't need a ton, it's just hard to absorb it.
Right.
So, another reason to not be a vegetarian.
Jill, what's the risk of taking too much?
I don't know, somebody told me, oh, well, you shouldn't take that every day, and I'm like, really, why? And
it's a water-soluble vitamin. I mean, you would just eliminate it.
Well, I would think so, but just like,
well,
you know, anything,
taking
you
too much methylfolate, which is water-soluble, too, you know? I mean,
right.
you can. It's not that you can't, it's just, I don't know why. I don't have a
yeah.
When I'm giving B12, I'm not that nervous about it.
Okay.
Truthfully. All right, yeah, go ahead.
So I have probably too many questions to answer here, but I'm curious about your muscle testing, because our daughter, they thought she was over methylating, so pretty
yeah.
much the opposite of everything. Like when she has meat protein, she does not do well. So she's pretty much the opposite of everything here. But the way they tested her was they tested her histamine levels in her blood, and she
yeah.
came back normal, even though she has every single symptom of it. So I'm curious what your muscle testing would, does that look for over-methylating or pretty much just under-methylating? And also your comment about how you can be both, like, I'm just curious.
Yeah, I mean,
that.
Do you want to come up?
Sure. Yeah.
Well, I've been told I have loose connective tissue, and so then my muscles like tend to tighten up in the wrong way, and then I have issues with needing to go to a chiropractor all the time. That's a whole other thing.
All right, just go on your back. That's fine. So the one thing that's tough with anything, and I don't care if this is a methylation issue or if you have an immune issue or you have an adrenal issue, a lot of times, like, or a thyroid issue, like, people can be, like, when it comes to thyroid, they can be hypo and hyper at the same time. You can be hypoadrenic and hyperadrenic. I don't even know if that's a word, but you have hypoadrenal symptoms and hyperadrenal symptoms at the same time. Your immune system can be overactive and underactive in the same at the same time. So, and muscle testing is not the only way to try to figure this out, but it's just a cool way to try to figure out what the body's telling you, essentially. So what bothers you more, like hips or like upper back?
Hips.
Okay. So she, I'm just gonna do some tests on her here. You can lock this knee, push it out. And again, like from my perspective, I'm still coming at this stuff from a chiropractic point of view. Like I'm a chemical engineer actually, originally. So it's kind of, I think, why I gravitate towards this biochemistry aspect of things. But I still, the reason why I was asking her if she had any pain or something is, or if she has any areas that bother her, I still look at things like structurally first. Like it's so much easier to find imbalances in someone's nervous system when it's like, oh, my hip hurts. Like, all right, well, that's easy. I can find something wrong in your hip. It's harder when someone's like, I'm tired. I'm like, all right. And like test a bunch of stuff where I find something wrong. But the reason why I even know or even have like tried to learn this stuff is because if someone comes in with a chronic hip issue because they can't detoxify estrogen because they have a methylation problem, I'm trying to figure that out. Otherwise, all I would do is just keep adjusting your hip from a traditional chiropractic point of view. You just keep doing the same thing over and over again, and the person's gonna feel better. There's never really going to fix the problem. And eventually it's going to turn into something else, right?
It's going to keep kind of slipping out of
place.
Like, you know,
just describing me
better. Yeah, right. So, she's standing and she has, like, ligament laxity. So, a lot of times that's, like, an estrogen problem. So, straight knee here, bring this leg out to the side, push out. That's good. Bring your leg up, turn it this way, hold it right. Tighten his shoes.
Why to less?
Donna, don't let me turn you out. Good, relax. Bring this leg up, turn that in, hold it there. Don't let me turn out.
I forgot which way I'm going.
You
don't
want to stay like
out.
That?
Okay.
I'm trying to pull your foot ahead. Yeah. Okay, so she has a weakness on that muscle. Keep that there again. Hold it. Okay, relax then. This will be easier if you go on your stomach, actually.
Okay.
Breathe over there. All right, so that muscle that was weak on her, bring your leg over this way. Hold it right there.
This is gonna not work.
Yeah, this is the same muscle.
Yeah.
So sometimes it changes though, depending on where your hip is. But go towards your right leg. Okay, so I can pull that away from her pretty easily, all right? So let me just see. Go towards that right leg. That turn. Bring this up again. Towards the right leg. Okay. Towards that right leg. Good. This time, think hard about this test. Think hard about going that way.
Okay.
Now pull hard. Alright, let that go. Pull again. That's good. Relax it down.
you were just put, like, talking about the points that you're pushing.
Yeah, I'll do it in one second. Okay, I'm just kind of curious where we're going to end up here. So bend this knee in. Go towards that left leg. Do that one more time. All right, relax that. Okay, you can go on your... Well, actually, stay there for a second. So, because it's hard for you guys to feel the muscle test, right? So you can kind of see when I'm pulling on it that it's weak, but this is usually easier to see. If you just bend your knees, and so like this, that heel actually gets further than that one, right? So you can kind of see like that unbalanced shape is there. If you touch your left jaw, like right there, and then bend your knees again, you can see how that changes. Okay. All right. Go on your back.
My husband's looking
fine. That's the worst. So vestibular issues, a lot of people have TMJ issues. That vestibular issues, actually, that's pretty funny.
I didn't know I had TMJ issues. So.
Well, a lot of people have TMJ thing going on. That's not a big deal, actually. All right. Go that way.
This way?
Yeah, that's good. All right. Stay like that. Go back. Good. Stay. Go back. Alright. Eyes up on the right. Go back. Okay. Eyes straight. Good. I'm just gonna take that shoe off, okay? Oh, correct toes?
Yes.
Yeah, all this stuff here. Alright. Bring your foot. You can drop your hand down.
Okay.
Bring your foot up. Hold that right there. Don't let me push it down, okay? Okay. So you can feel like that should be really strong.
Yeah.
Alright. Bring that up again. Don't let me push it down. Okay. Alright, so the first place I have to treat on you is actually like in this ankle.
Okay. And that's making my hips weak and all that?
That's what's driving your hip issue right now.
Okay.
But let's just check some nutrients off of that. So take your left hand, touch your jaw, tip your head back, go back, do it again. That turns out. See if you can feel this, because this will be hard for them. So, all right. Actually, take that hand away. Bring this up. Go back. Strong. Okay. Go back. That makes it weak.
Okay.
Normal. That should happen.
Okay.
Okay. Take your hand. Push your hand. Tip your head back. Go back. All right. That makes it weak because of your jaw.
Okay.
This is Sammy. Touch your jaw, tip your head back, go back. That turns it back on.
Yeah.
But if we go like this, bring it down, head back, go back, doesn't shut off.
Yeah.
That's not good.
Okay.
Either. So it's like, this is taking things like really out of context, and normally I wouldn't test nutrients in that way, but that's kind of like how you can see, like, in this very instant, you actually don't test while on Sammy. But there might be another point, you might be able to do some things that, oh, now your body can handle it.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay.
So, like, if you go on your stomach again, and, all right, so if we bend those knees again, keep your legs relaxed. Okay, so we're still here, right? And this is what I need to treat under, so if I rub over this area that needs to get treated, and bend those knees again, and then that happens. With that, we got that same effect from the jaw, actually. But this is like driving her jaw problem right now. This is probably not making any sense, but bend this knee.
I can feel the difference.
Bend this knee, we go back to this original problem, because her primary issue was like hip stuff, right? Go towards that way. All right, do that one more time, pull hard. Okay, so I can bring that back pretty easily. And pull over again, like that. That was pretty good.
Yeah.
You can feel how much better that
was.
The interesting thing was with her, is when I tested Sammy on her, she actually showed this like strengthening response. You're thinking, oh, maybe she needs methylation support. But then if I tested the muscle to see if that muscle was shut off, it actually wouldn't shut off. It made the muscle like too tight. So then you'd be like, oh, well, that's not good either. Sometimes that's even worse on weakness, actually.
That's my problem.
Yeah, well, so, yeah, it'd be hard to say. Well, so then, yeah, you want your back there. I guess the point of showing you this is it's just an example of how you can look at the nervous system at a point in time. So like at this point in time, she doesn't show a good response to Sammy. If we look at her ankle, it's gonna help her hip, but it's probably not the only thing that's gonna help her hip. There's probably a lot of things going on. Let me just check some stuff off. Like glutathione helps her, so maybe there's some like antioxidant issue that you have going on, you know?
Behind you on the floor, between your feet.
Between your feet, oh jeez.
So it was cysteine. Cysteine is kind of key for detoxifying hormones. Touch of her head back, go back. That's magnesium. Go back. All right. So like, if you go on your stomach, bend that knee. Bring your leg over that way, towards the left leg. So that's magnesium. Like that turns that muscle on pretty significantly. Now, like, again, this is really taking things like out of context, but you kind of see the thought process of what happens there. Like, you're trying to figure out what this person needs for her nervous system to kind of get back in balance. Like, so with magnesium out there, and we bend her knees, her nervous system goes back in balance, basically. All right. Yeah, thanks for coming.
Yeah, that was pretty helpful.
Yeah.
So let's say she was a patient of yours, you put her on the different supplements, how long would she be on those before you would work on the next thing? To try to delve deeper? I'm just curious in general what the process is.
The initial look is really long.
Yeah.
So like, I don't even know if I would give her magnesium, truthfully. Because as soon as you start treating stuff, like start treating her ankle,
mm-hmm.
like... She might end up not showing a need for magnesium. It's just like kind of the way it works. Like in the beginning, there's a lot of things you can test on a patient that they'll show a good response to. But sometimes you're just feeding a compensation. And it's not that feeding the compensation is bad, but if you really got to what the root issue was, then they wouldn't necessarily need the magnesium. That being said, I get magnesium all the time. It's like one of the most common supplements I have to give. But the process that, so what would happen there is I would have treated her foot, and then there's a good chance that that hip muscle would have turned on, and then I would have looked for another hip weakness or something, and just started, and then worked off of that. So it's just like, basically on her, I would have treated her foot, and then just see what I had to treat next, and then just keep going over and over and over again, until I get to a certain point where there's an ideal point for me to test nutrients on a person, and it shows up in a specific way.
So you would
way.
Work structurally and then get into the...
Yeah, sort of. I don't always work structurally first, depending on what shows up first on the patient. It's just structurally usually shows up first. But, like my everyone that does this type of work, like, we all got our own biases, right? I'm biased towards like these structural issues and biochemical imbalances. So like if someone comes to me with like emotional stuff, it's not that I don't treat it, it's like I don't treat it in traditional ways people think of, like EFT or some of those like emotional release things. I'm thinking if someone's coming to me with an emotional problem, like, all right, what neurotransmitters are messed up? Maybe their gut's messed up. When I can fix their gut, then the neurotransmitters will get better, and then that will fix it. Or something like that. Or like they can't sleep, or they have anxiety. You're looking at, well, why are they stressed out? Maybe they're stressed out because they can't clear out cortisol or stress hormones from their body. If you do that, then they'll start sleeping better. That being said, like people that do emotional stuff can definitely help too. Like I know, like if I get mentally stressed out, my sleep can suck. Doesn't necessarily mean I need like to detox it. It's just, but that's kind of like my approach basically. So. You guys can ask me questions about anything, honestly. You don't have to talk about methylation. Just general
actually, I have one question not related to this, but yet related. I'm familiar with some people that have problems when they take SAMe, like really severe. Does that indicate anything? Like they get like severe anxiety or anything?
Yeah.
Is that anything?
I don't recommend it, truthfully, as a supplement. People can get those same like anxiety symptoms if they take too much methylfolate too, actually.
Does that indicate anything in that cycle? I guess this might.
Well, the one thing that can happen if you take too much SAMe is one thing that's a problem. Sorry. Alright, take too much of this. You're gonna end up here, and that's a problem. You don't want to be there. So, not to mention, just if you over methylate things, like that can be a problem too. Like methylation, when it comes to your DNA, it typically silences genes. So, which can be really good if you got like a promoter gene in your body that like is a gene that might promote cancer. But it might be bad if you have a gene that protects you against cancer. So like the way to, in general with methylation when it comes to genetics, it's more of a silencer. And that's actually why I didn't really talk about viral infections, but methylation is really key for like say someone's got like Epstein-Barr, like mono, to like silence, to shut that mono or that viral replication process down. It usually takes like the methylation cycle is put under demand to shut that down. So the cool thing is if your methylation capacity is good, then the odds on like something like Epstein-Barr coming back in your body aren't gonna be as strong because your body's like keeping that silence with these like methyl groups, if that makes sense. Yeah, does that answer, I don't know if I answered your question really, but.
I was just curious because it's a brother and a sister and they both.
Yeah.
They both tried it at different times. And they both like got really anxious from
yeah.
I guess is what the anxiety.
Chris Masterjohn has a good explanation on like how methylation affects like your dopamine, almost like your dopamine cycles in your brain. I have to look at it again to give you a reason for it. But it has to do with like almost like the rigidity of your thoughts. It's like if people have like post-traumatic stress disorder, they might be like poor methylators because they're essentially their brain gets like trapped in this one thought that they can't get rid of type of thing.
Like in a cycle.
Yeah. But then if you get over methylated, then your brain might just be like all over the place too. Like I honestly gotta listen to it again because I didn't really understand it and look at it long enough. But the biggest thing, the easiest thing to say would be like, oh, you're making too much of that, which is neurotoxin.
Do you recommend any resources to better understand this process for a lay person?
Oh, I wrote them on that thing, on that sheet. There's like four different websites that I think are pretty good that talk about it. You can drive yourself crazy trying to understand all this stuff. In the end, doing the stuff they tell you to do here is the best way to start. So. Yeah, go ahead.
Do you have like major things to avoid, like if you're a form methylator? Like I know nitrous oxide is something you shouldn't use, and things like that.
Glutamate, MSG is big, actually. That would be for sure. But any like estrogen issues, I would say, because you need methylation to detox estrogen. So like things like soy, that can be like these different estrogen sources in your body can definitely be a problem. Other things that cause you to have too much estrogen in your body is insulin. If your insulin levels are high, it'll upregulate your body's conversion to estrogen, so you'll make more estrogen if you have too much insulin around. So if you back that up, well, what causes insulin to go up? And that's gonna be like carbohydrates, refined carbohydrates, and that type of stuff. I mean, the more you can limit your toxic exposure, the better. So like, I mean, like right, like I've been snow blowing like crazy the last 2 days, and I probably need to be taking some like detox stuff because I'm breathing in this freaking like smoke exhaust so much.
Glycine helps bind to the petrochemicals and
yeah.
Safely detox them also. So glycine's good for that kind of detoxification also from the fumes from airplanes and cars.
Yeah, glycine's a pretty useful nutrient. I don't supplement with it that much. Usually when I supplement with it, I kind of give like I don't give, for some reason, Thorne, the one that I use, like it's like 200 something capsules in the bottle. I usually just like take some out and then give it to the person. Like try to like jumpstart the process of making it, but it doesn't really ever hurt anyone taking glycine. Really never had like a detrimental thing from taking too much of that, but yeah.
I'm curious, so you were talking about the process of like under-methylating or over-methylating. How fast does that process like swing from one to the other? Is that something that can happen in a day, multiple times a day, or does it take like weeks or, you know,
not
how long?
Sure, truthfully.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd have to look more into it, honestly. But I mean, I'm still learning this stuff. Like it's not, part of it is the information isn't like locked down. Like they don't really know, they don't really have this stuff like exact. The takeaway is do the stuff they tell you to do here, you're going to be better off. But as far as our knowledge is, because the other thing too when it comes to like genetics, this is the problem if like you get one of those genetic tests and you're like, these are the supplements I'm supposed to be taking based off this genetic test. Truth is, we don't know that much about it. And at the same time, like we know a decent amount about this MTHFR thing now, but there might be some other gene that kind of counteracts it. We haven't really figured out how it complements it, you know? So, and then like this is like another CBS gene, anyone heard of that? CBS, yeah. I have one patient that's like super sensitive to sulfur. Like if she eats too much like broccoli or something, she gets really funny. It's because she has like this genetic thing that upregulates the CBS thing. So she, her homocysteine is always getting sent down. She's always making like cysteine. Keep learning more and more about it. At the same time, the fundamental like things you need to do to be healthy are kind of the same. Those like really aren't changing. So, anyone else got any questions? You can ask me about anything if you had a question about just something not related to this.
How about if someone is, you brought up the diabetic type thing with
yeah.
You know, high insulin levels, high sugar levels, whatever. If a person's getting their diet in order, starting that, is there anything they have to watch out for? Or they can help with this process as they're bringing, say somebody's chronically high in their insulin, high in their
yeah.
sugar numbers, like 200-300, and they're trying to get it down. And that's obviously eating right
yeah.
the main thing. Is there any in this methylation cycle to help recover from that so that their body
say you're a bad methylator and you have diabetes, I mean improving your methylation status and eating better should improve your blood sugar numbers also. I mean, so truthfully, that's a bad way to answer your question, but if you, most of the time, if you're doing what you're supposed to do and your blood sugar numbers aren't changing, typically that's like a gut issue going on. Like there's some like fungal bacterial thing that's screwing that up. And that being said, a lot of your body's inherent folate, we'll just say that, comes from like a good gut flora. So if you can change your gut flora by changing your diet, which you can somewhat, that might improve your methylation status without even taking it. That makes sense. Typically, to like really change that gut flora, you do need some like, I use like herbal antibiotics or something along those lines, but usually you kind of need something. Just changing your diet alone sometimes isn't enough, but yeah, sometimes it is. So.
If you have a mutation, are you supposed to also be gluten-free, or does that just kind of go hand in hand?
No, I don't think you necessarily have to be.
I guess not have to be, but do find that oftentimes they're gluten sensitive as well.
Not necessarily. Okay. Yeah. I don't find gluten sensitivity as much as probably the next like natural provider. I think a lot of gluten sensitivity is driven from infections and like a FODMAP issue first. Mm-hmm. If you fix that and improve their tolerance of FODMAPs, then you should be able to have gluten.
I shouldn't say permanent, because like my daughter we don't know if she has a mutation. We didn't go that far, but she was having an methylation issue.
Yeah.
Took her off the gluten for a while, but now she's back on.
And
she's fine. So.
And like you're doing that with gluten, right?
Yeah.
So like I mean, he's always looking at infections and like gluten isn't. Most people are going to be better not eating it. Like, there's not really a reason to eat it. The only reason to probably eat those types of products would be is like you aren't getting, if you're going like too low carb, you actually can like starve out your good gut flora, which can be a problem. But for the most part, you take anybody and you say, yeah, don't eat gluten, they're gonna do better, whether they got a sensitivity to it or not. You know, like I don't think I have sensitivity to it. I feel better if I eat less of it. Plus the other thing too is if I'm not eating bread, odds are I'm eating something healthier because it's just the way it is. It's not super, bread isn't like super nutritious, right? Or those types of things. So I wouldn't necessarily say though, if you have a methylation issue, you have to go gluten free. But,
All right.
Thank you. All right.
Thanks
for coming,
guys.
Information in this lecture is provided for informational purposes only and is not intended to substitute for the advice provided by your doctor or other healthcare professionals. You should not rely upon or follow the program or techniques or use any of the products and services made available by or through the lecture without obtaining the advice of a physician or other healthcare professional. The nutritional and other information in this lecture are not intended to be and do not constitute healthcare or medical advice.